Good morning, everyone. My name is Ken Goldberg. I'm the director of the Citrus People and Robots Initiative, and it's a pleasure to welcome you here today. I want to also welcome the web visitors who are connecting online and watching us remotely. I also want to mention that the research exchange schedule is online, so the schedule for the rest of the semester will be posted. Where's Yvette? Where is she? Okay, I don't see her, but even though she's not here, I want to give her a round of applause because she has organized all of this. And deserves a huge credit for that. The lunch thing, all the lunches are compostable, so you could just take whatever that, the whole thing, and put it in the compost section, I've been told. And also, there's going to be something special going on at the Foundry this on February 8th, next week, from 6 to 8 p.m. right here in this room. The Foundry is hosting a screening of a short film called She Started It, which is it follows five young entrepreneurs, women entrepreneurs, in their process of competing in the entrepreneurial ruthlessly competitive boys club of high tech startups. So that's available here again, 6 to 8 p.m. On the 8th. So today's speaker, though, I'm very happy to say, is a terrific scholar, researcher, engineer, and friend. I've known him for a number of years. He actually is a Cal grad, so go Bears. He once upon a time, actually 1980, early 80s, he was here in the Eakes department. So he got his start here, and he went on to do many things. He is most widely known as the playing a fundamental role in the open source computer vision library, OpenCV. And he ran that. He also was very active in the role of Stanley, the team that won the DARPA Grand Challenge at that other university. And then he has done a lot of work over there. He's worked at the AI lab at Stanford. And then he was involved with the design of a new robot at that time, which then became Willow Garage. And the Willow Garage system, he was CTO, or very actively leading teams there, combining vision with manipulation. And then he went on to work in, he did a startup related to video, and that was sold to Microsoft. And then he did another startup related to industrial manipulation that was called industrial perception. That was bought by Google. And then he went to Magic Leap, that you may know as the augmented reality company. And he left there and is now doing something new. And this is what I'm hoping we're going to hear something about today.
We'll hear something.
All right. But whatever it is, you're going to get a new perspective. He's had a fantastic career in really at the cutting edge of robotics and computer vision. He's a Bear. Please welcome Gary Bradski.
Is this on, or can you hear? Thanks, Ken, and glad to be back. I've been back a couple of times here over the years. I was busy at Magic Leap. You can Google Magic Leap and Bradski, and you'll see there was a bit of a battle in leaving, so that's all settled now, and I started this company. So I'm rather between things, and the new company is called Array, and I'll talk about it as much as I can. But it's quite young. We closed funding 2 weeks ago, so there's not a lot of mature stuff. But I'll talk about what we're doing. I'm calling this Reifying Dreams. If you know. Reify means to make real, make actual, and so it's been a bit of my career, and it is kind of the defining role of this company, as you'll see, in a different way. So much of my career has ended up being in being an entrepreneur, and maybe it's the one thing I actually do well. After all these years, but I'm just learning how to do it well. But it, I'm getting too old to do it. But that's life. So you know, I've had a lot of roles, and each one I've sort of broken the boundaries. At Intel, I was doing this OpenCV library. I got a lot of back pressure from it. You know, when I had my advisor in my PhD, we fought a lot. I was with a student said, "Oh, he doesn't want to make, you know, Ken wait. He doesn't want to make Ken mad." I go, "No, you want to make him mad, but you know, otherwise he won't respect you." But anyhow, I've done a lot of the breaking the rules, so these are just like my words to live by. Maybe it won't work for you. I've had this career that's sort of less planned. I think it's a little bit like having kids. If you think about it too much, you never would have done it. But and that led to both the advantage. I did the OpenCV, this library that's gone all over the world, and did all these companies and was in the right spot at the right time, partly by taking risks. It's also what got me sued by Magic Leap. So. I did learn that just because you're charged with something doesn't mean you're guilty. But I used to not think that, but you know. one of the things that I've done in the career is, I think this tends to be true, you're never known for what you do. You're known for what you do outside of what you're supposed to do. And that was like Stanley doing the DARPA Grand Challenge and all these other side things. It is a bit stressful sometimes. Often that my focus has been building tools in the end, and that's sort of what this company that I'm doing is doing. So here's just the, like, we're gonna just start with the sort of things that I've started, whether they're companies or not. And you know, first is, and I'll get into this more, but I hope YouTube is connecting, but maybe I have to start it. I'm not sure. Anyhow, it doesn't matter. This is one of our Google Summer of Code videos that shows a whole bunch of stuff, and I don't know why it's not running now. Maybe none of them are going to run. I don't know if I can get over here and try to click that. But in any case, this computer vision library, I'm going to talk in more detail about it, but it's around the world, and every university that has a CS department in the world is using this, and basically any vision company in the world is using this, and it all started from my hard disk, and you know, they told me at Intel Research they wanted me to publish papers, and so, you know, because they wanted to put them on the map, and so that became my low priority. I said, nah, I'm going to do this instead because this is higher impact. And so, you know, right away I was breaking the rules. And you know, I ended up getting a division award for starting this, despite it being against what my managers wanted. And then they canceled it many times, but I kept it going. And at one point, you know, one of the Russians team members who's working with me, they're going to fire him because he wouldn't stop working on it. So we had all kinds of funds like that on it. Damn, it looks like this wants to start. Anyhow, Stanley, too bad. Maybe it's just slow YouTube. Stanley is a car that... this was a narration by Sebastian Thrawn, who led the project. Was this car that won the DARPA Grand Challenge, which was an off-road race, this 2005. And it's really the thing that started the whole... I loaded it direct link to YouTube, but it was running on my home machine. I mean... you know, maybe I can, if I can get over here, maybe I can get it to run. Go. See, it is a YouTube link. Yeah.
In my own research, I've extensively used machine learning for robotics. You see here is a robot my students and I built at Stanford called Stanley, and it won the DARPA Grand Challenge. It's a self-driving car that drives without any human assistance whatsoever. And this vehicle extensively uses machine learning.
So
The robot is equipped with a laser system.
Cut out Sebastian Thrun because he outranks me. But, so this car, what happened is, Larry Page took it into Google to do Street View. And really, Street View was just a cover for Google making maps, and because they were using TomTom at the time. But that was Stanley's engine. And then with the Urban Challenge, whatever, this became the whole rush to autonomous driving. And Stanley's in the Smithsonian, the Air and Space Museum, second floor. Whenever I go there, I give impromptu lectures. But, so this was kind of revolutionary. Now, at Intel, I was told, don't work on it. We're not sponsoring it, blah, blah, blah. you can see in this original picture, there's no Intel logos. Well, it's because they were telling me, you're disrupting work and management. There's the vision algorithm segmenting the road. Not always correctly, but nevertheless, this was a super reliable car. The vision system never caused a failure. And Sebastian's making the point that we did a lot of machine learning. We couldn't get it to work until we just learned a policy over these observations, because the lasers were creating false walls every time it bounced and whatever. So, that was Stanley, and, it was pushed through and became very successful. Now, I think maybe when I have videos, I'll just do it this way. This was VideoSurf. It was the first major VideoSurf engine. I don't know that this video is so important to watch, but I thought, well, video's coming. I saw it, and at that time there was this company, an independent company called YouTube. They were small and starting up. We met. We were actually right across the street from one another. They were already getting big in traction, and so when we met, they wanted to buy us. And I said yes. My CEO said no. That's a talent buy. And I was saying I'm for sale, which was maybe too bad. But Microsoft eventually. I left to Willow Garage, and Microsoft eventually bought this, and it's still part of their search engine. In Bing or in their games. And here these are all, this was industrial perception. Let me see if I can get at least some of these to run. Maybe if I launch this. Anyhow, this was coming out of Willow Garage. Damn it. Okay. This is a robot with vision systems, and it's unpacking those pallets, and it's unloading a truck, and there's a pick-and-place application. It's probably still near state-of-the-art, although it's done with suction. So we were in Willow Garage, and I was getting frustrated that they weren't working on real problems, so I got together a bunch of people, and we spun out, and I looked around, and the obvious area to go was manufacturing, but then I looked at distribution, and there's no robots there unless you count conveyor belts, with switches. And so we thought, well, it's better to be the one person, one robot in distribution rather than there are robots in manufacturing. They're all dumb and blind, but they're there. And so we went into distribution, and we got a lot of pickup, We ended in a bidding war between Google and Amazon. I didn't want to sell to either. I thought we had more mileage and could have done better. But, the kids I was with, grad students or kids, they saw money and they liked Google. And I said, Google's going to be a disaster for you, which it was. Because they're doing a moonshot again instead of doing, I thought Amazon's going to have very pragmatic problems and you'll actually make progress. But, that was that. But this robot, if we could get it to move, maybe I'll try one more time. It moves surprisingly fast and whatever. We'd have to get it at human rates. And so I thought we were really 5 years off on getting this thing to work. But, and we were sort of 13 months in when Google bought us. Maybe it'll go now. So this is something Motoman, Yaskawa, they took our film to advertise themselves, but that's going into a truck and unloading it. This one is, oh, is that going to stop? Well, this one might be more fun. This is just unloading pallets, and so it's sizing up the boxes and then making a plan, and it's just putting them on a conveyor belt, and this guy's feeding them in. And, you know, so it was fairly fast, and, you know, deciding. It turns out anytime you do this, you think, oh, we chose boxes because there's billions of boxes moving through distribution, and they seem to be a nice geometric object. But it turns out, like, anytime you do stuff the real, boxes can look like pumpkins in the, you know, in the real world. So there's all kind, you know, you get potato chips covered with grease so the suction won't stick for them, and they reuse the boxes so they turn into, like, pumpkin shapes. Or you get people who use brand new boxes that are corrugated, and you're supposed to find the gap between the boxes, but it's all corrugated, and the gap is less than the corrugation. So you find all these kind of edge conditions as you do with any real work, and you know, it keeps life interesting. This is one of the things I say is, like, one thing you can do in life is work on boring problems, because they're really interesting. You know, once you get into something, I've got a friend that I'm an advisor in, an agricultural apple picking robot, and, like, you have no idea, like, apples don't grow on trees. The ones you eat that did not grow on a tree. They grow on something that looks like a vine, and you learn all kinds of stuff about industries you never knew and that are fairly interesting. So here's the last company that I'll get into more, but it's Array. I was going to do a robotics company. I was talking with Ken, but that got caught up in the suit. This was another company I was just talking with my friend in Google X, and we were talking about ideas with whiskey, and got to be 3 a.m., and he said, I just resigned. And so off we're going on this company, literally in a garage. But I don't put much here. I'll talk more about it later. But we're trying to change filmmaking, apply learning to make basically visual storytelling easier or fluid. And that's what we're doing. This thing has applications in sensing. So as we get the sensor working, I hope to distribute it to robotics departments and whomever, because I think there's a ton of stuff, both in research and just what deep nets can do with light fields. There's not much on it because no one has it. Turns out the hardware is a super pain. Even simple things like synchronizing cameras, it's not easy to get right and to get reliable, and the data flows and whatever. So now I'm going to switch. So that was an overview. I'm going more into detail on OpenCV. People familiar with OpenCV? Usually I'm talking with vision audiences, and some people have the new book. Anyhow, just to go over it. I've been making tools, and this is one of the key tools that's used around the world. It's the open source computer vision library. It's a free and open source library, the BSD, Berkeley Source Distribution. I wanted it to be used. This is one of those things where I guess the timing was right. I got in, Intel wanted me to do papers, but I thought academics are really good at doing papers. Why are we competing? Whereas we'd be good at leveraging things. And so I pursued this instead. I did do papers in the end, but this was the main focus. And I went to Media Labs, and I saw that they were way ahead in vision because they had all these tools that each grad student inherited. And so I wanted to give it to everyone, and you know, that was that really worked. This is one of the few plans I've had in life that actually worked out as I envisioned. So that was the dream. You know, I thought, well, no one needed faster computers to do spreadsheets. So I said, well, vision is going to consume endless cycles, so that would be better for Intel. Everything I thought, you know, happened with this library. So it's still my baby. I'm still running it. This is moderately recent. It's up to 14.5 million downloads. These are only people who download the build code. I can't. There's a ton of people on Git or they get it in a Linux distribution. I can't track that. This is strictly from SourceForge, so it's not all of them by any means. But it's going now at 280,000 downloads a month, so it's quite popular. And the main countries you can see there are U.S., Japan, and China are the main users. Sometimes Europe lights up, but it's really used everywhere. I get, you know, invites from Iran, come by, you know, we're using or people who want to, you know, somewhere in Africa wants me to help them with some homework assignment. I only do it if they've really done their homework. But it's highly used. It's quite extensive coverage of image geometry and now also, of course, deep nets. So we have TinyDNN, which is a templated, fully functional DeepNet library. We're sort of aiming this at embedded, so we're doing a Google Summer of Code. If you're students, we can pay you to work on this stuff. But we're, you know, some of the aims are we want to look at reducing nets so they run on mobile. I can see a sort of big kind of cottage industry of just. There's all these old companies like Cognex and whatever that just do inspection and monitoring. And if you could just train things and run them on cheap architectures, there'd be a huge market for that. There's trillions of dollars of infrastructure that's like in the form of gauges, and none of it's on the internet. An easy way to get it on the internet is if you had a cheap camera that wakes up once a week, reads the gauge, and sends it off. There are gauges that are very inaccessible under buildings and, you know, this is all over the world, and one of the problems. So I see a ton of things, and in industrial inspection and whatever. That's one thing for the deep learning. So we're trying to support this in the library as getting some core things like human recognition, face recognition, just to have a reference sort of thing there. One of the most used things in this library is calibration, so we continue to add like multi-camera and strange configurations. A lot of people in VR, so I've added new calibration patterns. We're going to continue that. Calibration for wide-angle lenses and other things, which turns out to be important. So where is it used? I mean, I already sort of went over it. Probably used in the new Google robot. It was used in Stanley. It's everywhere in the world. I've seen it used in. I've seen it saving lives, drowning lives. It's a European company. It's monitoring mine equipment. You know, it's in part. When you use Google Maps and Street View, it's, you know, little part. Some algorithm is in there from it. So it's all over the place. This is just saying more of it, things that I've heard. Interestingly, what I might want to build on, maybe I'll do some of the summers. It's like in Barcelona, people are using it in performance art, so interactive things, and I'd like to support that more. Anyway, so OpenCV was recently revamped into full C++, and you know this is kind of the timeline of that. We're now just released 3.2, so it's getting like very professional code. We run these summer codes, we're running it again. It's good for students because we teach them how to produce professional rather than spaghetti code. We have build bots and tools and structures. So, you know, that's of use when you want to get someone actually being useful. What we've done is we've shrunk the core of it, so the geometric algorithms. And around it, we have this contrib, so there's two GitHubs. And that's all sort of the higher level functionality in the library. And, you know, you can see this all online, trying to make the documentation better and better. I'm trying to get higher level support of this library, like much more funds, so we can just keep it going and start doing workshops and whatever. I've always been looking for someone to run this, but it turns out, like, academic skills don't always intersect with business skills. I've never been able to find someone to take it and run, but still looking. Huawei is, though, going to put in enough funds to pay such a person now. Anyhow, so we're working a lot on getting it more optimized, and so it was the basis or one of the key bases of this OpenVX, which is a hardware acceleration layer. This is all this nitty-gritty stuff that maybe doesn't matter academically, but it really matters of getting things to work right. All these companies have agreed to these standards. OpenCV vastly exceeds those standards, but it's kind of conforming to that. I mean, it has much more functionality. It takes a long time to get people to agree, but this is sort of a good move if you want to, you know, get really usable stuff. It's sort of key. If things are fast enough, people experiment with it, and that's like the story of deep nets. They've been around for decades, and why didn't they come into use? Partly it's data, but partly was the compute and speed. There's a lot. So I'm just highlighting some functionality. It's kind of interesting. This computational photography, there's now a big module. It does all kinds of things like high dynamic range imaging. There's a lot of stuff that's good for robotics, like that can bring out surface properties and other things you might want in a robot. I'll get a little into that in array. We're doing light fill, but you know, if you move, you can see the lights playing off the surface differently. Well, that allows you to separate surface from light, and this is important for robots or cars skidding and, you know, on roads and whatever, to be able to tell if something's wet or slippery or different surface properties. This is some of the calibration I was talking with. I just invented this a year or two ago. Of just the checkerboards are kind of, well, there's calibration pattern, and so you see the typical Aruko in the middle. The problem is, what's the definition of a hard corner? It's at some threshold. There's no real definition of where a corner starts and ends. With a checkerboard, there is. It's like the, you know, the in-between. The bias or error on one side is canceled by the other. And so I combined the two in this Chiruko, and that's become very popular because it labels each corner, and now you get complex camera systems where the cameras never see the same view, and this allows you to put it into one calibration framework very easily. This summer, I want to improve that. This was just a stopgap. I want to actually just make these sort of April or Aruko tags as a checkerboard themselves. Partly, we've been using this to track, and the little signs get too small, so I want to fix that. This is just stuff I do on the side. Okay, so there's deep net libraries here. There's two. TinyDNN is just a template-based, C++ template-based DNN network that does learning and all kinds of stuff. We're hoping like to focus it on embedded. There's so many people doing deep nets. It might end up being, its main use might be, end up being as a teaching tool because it's simple. It's just a header file and you can actually understand what deep nets are. They're actually fairly simple. It's just the chain rule writ large, you know. And so, in fact, of all these technologies, I worked early in speech with hidden Markov models, which are way more complex than deep nets. So it's kind of like a simple technology is becoming very effective. There's reasons for it. This layered representation seems to be a really good idea. You always have to keep in mind the no free lunch theorem, that there is no optimal classifier on the space of all distributions. But the fact is, we don't live on that space. We live on these human distributions, and this seems to be an effective way of dealing with things. There's also this DNN, and that is just taking the output, the learned networks from TensorFlow, Keras, and they're hoping to get Torch, and trying to run it efficiently on embedded. Intel is doing this, so it's going to run on Intel's embedded. But Intel is one of the major licensors of ARM, so we'll see. Okay, this is a... let me see if I can get it running. Okay, it's not too interesting, but this is the library running. So this is a kind of AlexNet that's recognizes, I forget what, a 1,000 classes or something, and it does quite well. That's TinyCNN, DNN. So that's available. It is a very simple library that you can get, you know, your hands around. And I believe this is the end of OpenCV discussion. So that's the library. You just have to search for it. Everything's keyed off this main site, or it references you to GitHub, where all the code is and the wiki is. We just came out with this book. It became oversized, but it's very comprehensive on the C++, so it's a good reference. We try to explain vision algorithms in simple ways. Again, it's the geometric vision. I was just having discussions about this on where is vision going to go? Is it all going deep? So far, what I found in my work is regression kinds of things. I want to do stereo depth. We have a cool Russian mathematician guy who we have camera arrays, and he's trying to do an end-to-end stereo thing, and he's unsupervised. And the reason he can do this is he's made a cost function that plays off geometric constraints that has to be satisfied. And so you don't really need any ground truth given to you. The geometric constraints are enough. Hopefully, he's making progress. But on the other hand, I just took one of the top algorithms, which, again, it has deep nets embedded, the patch matching. It's a patch match algorithm, but it put it in an optimization framework of a graph. Once you get in these problems, they're non-convex. So you end up in graph minimization kinds of things. This is what Malik did at Berkeley. These kind of algorithms, alpha expansion, to do the stereo. And that's right now it's beating it, and it's getting very accurate stereo. So I think maybe these hybrid algorithms might come through. We had another guy do eye tracking at another company, and it's a mathematician. He had a beautiful model of the eye as two spheroids, and then they wanted to do end-to-end deep network. They ended up, after 6 months of trying, just using his math model because it was a fairly accurate model of the eye, and the deep net cleans up the noise so you can find glints, true glints on the eye, and pour that in the math algorithm, that turns out to be fast and accurate. So it's kind of an interesting thing of me to see how far these are going to go. Are we going to end up with hybrid systems? Some things, you know, when you know the geometry, or it's like a Kalman filter, okay, it's optimal. Like, you're not going to do better than optimal. So I don't, you know, I tend to think these hybrid things are going to be forever when you have knowledge. But so this is... OpenCV is getting funding, and this is one plea for people. There's this Google Summer of Code, so you're paid to work at home and on code. On all these projects that are listed on this wiki, you can see Google Summer of Code, OpenCV, and you'll find our ideas page. We try to work with students so they can suggest their own idea and, you know, make it work with their thesis or whatever. Mostly we're taking... graduate students, though we've had some real success with sharp undergraduates. Okay, so array, finally. Light fields, deep learning. Okay, so the company's new. I can't give all its secrets away, but I'll generally describe what we're doing and the kinds of things that are being worked with. So this is just a little, maybe it's a reminder for people on what are light fields, what's planoptics, and so... What the real goal in capturing a scene is to capture all properties of the scene, the surfaces, the lighting, everything, from every viewpoint. And that's the planoptic function. So it's 5 degrees of freedom, right? It's basically take a picture in each space, each place in space, so you have a rho theta of where a ray is hitting that. And then you have x, y, z, so you know where you are in space. And so it's 5D. And, you know, if you had a camera and put it everywhere, or if you have a robot moving a camera, you can actually capture every ray in the scene, reproduce things. You can reproduce views without knowing the geometry, and there's all kinds of nice properties of noise reduction and ray consistency. You can do a lot. Gordon White's, I have him written down. There's some, like... whole bunch of papers in the 90s and then in the mid-2000s on light fields, and then it's dried up, and now maybe it's coming back because the hardware is coming on and people are starting deep learning. But I sort of did it here, like, you know, if you have a 360 view, and you hope put a whole bunch of them, you've captured every point in space, right? That's these supposed to be these blue spheres. Now, let's move on. That's plan optics. That's not a light field. So what's light field? Light field, as you see, you know, and so if you're capturing every ray in space, you'll see it's mostly going through redundant cameras. So really all you need is to capture, you know, one plane in space. Well, to make it visible, I just did this one. So if we have this, the top of it, so if we have this, I really can get these directions just by sampling two, and that's the light field. So this is now 4 degrees of freedom. You still have the direction the light's coming, but now it's just a plane. So you're X, Y in that plane, and then finding the direction of light. And you do that because you have, it hits multiple cameras. You can triangulate, get depth in the scene. And so this is the, you know, sort of the high level basics of light fields. So you make an array of cameras. That's the simplistic way of doing things. That's what we're doing. You have LITRO, and they made, I don't remember whether I'm getting into this. Ah, yeah, maybe I do. I don't even know if that's visible. So either you do an array of cameras, these are the naive ways of doing things, and we're doing that because sometimes the naive ways are pragmatic and hardware is getting cheap in China. But you had LITRO, who I think made a lot of wrong business decisions. I don't know if you can see it, but they put those little like half spheres on the imaging surface. So you basically have these lensings which you can determine, you can think of it as mini stereo on each, mini imagers on each section of the imager. And so you can get the light field right on one sensor. The problem is they have to make these sensors that are very expensive to make, whereas Shenzhen is making a new camera every other week. And so we think this is a better way of doing that. Now, there's much more clever ways of doing this that are really cool, and I think I'm getting into it. Yeah, so I'm stealing all these pictures from Stanford and MIT sites. As one way of doing this. So imaging is starting to get interesting in that you're sort of doing imaging with non-image forming sensors, so diffraction gratings and all kinds of stuff. And we are starting to get into that turns out you can do very clever things with polarization. So you get a lot of polarization, you can like directly derive surface normals from it. And so there's a lot of stuff that is interesting to play with. Here they're just putting a kind of mask. This is just a piece of like film that has black and white and gray dots sprinkled on it. And so what you get is like in some directions the light's blocked, in some directions it's not, and you get rays. And so in one imager, from this simple adaptation, you can get rays. And this is a lot of work that was done at Stanford. This kind of shows that you'll get directed rays and you can reconstruct them. And this is a series, it's called compressive imaging. There's a series of papers, but you know, basically they optimize this pattern and show that you can get very fine reconstruction, light field reconstruction and parallax on a single imager. So this is a really sort of interesting and elegant way of doing things. I think Gordon at Stanford also has two LCDs together in front of an imager. And you can see by turning on different pixels, you can actually steer which direction you want to receive light from, and again, do a completely dynamic light field that way. So this is like very interesting work, and people are doing diffractive gratings and whatever. Why aren't we doing it? Well, we're interested, but we need to earn money as a company. And this is a little too academic right now, although I'm tracking the work. The interesting thing, okay, so it's Gordon Weitzien. He's doing a lot of this work, and he did a lot of the early papers. You see all these papers from the 90s that, you know, it's funny, the web didn't archive these things, and so a lot of papers were forgotten that are really valuable that are only now online. So it's worth maybe rereading some of these things. But he's reversing that process. Like, you know, you can do this in many ways. Like, you're putting out a light. So this is one of the possible competitors that'll come out to, like, augmented reality. These are holographic displays because they're emitting. It's as if, you know, you've taken this plane where you gathered all the rays, but now you're imposing a plane and you're putting out the rays. And so wherever your eyes, it makes it completely as if that was a window into the scene. The light's exactly the same. And so your eyes will do focus and accommodation. This is the trick with augmented reality and virtual reality. In the natural world, you verge, you know, triangulate, and the focus system goes right there, and you get a reinforcement. You have one focus, many cues, one focus circuit. What happens in augmented reality, often, Google Glasses, that partly it gives, that makes people get a headache or feel sick, is you focus here, but you verge here, and what does your focus circuit do? It oscillates, and that gives you eye strain and whatever. It also turns, it's much more complex. You actually use different depth strategies, whether you're high or low in your field. Well, the light field is good because it accommodates, it future-proofs it against any display. It is the natural light in the scene. So no matter what they come out with, this is a good way of filming because you'll always be able to display it in any medium that they come out with. This technique is being used, or people are trying to do some version of this in different ways to get the augmented reality in a compact way. And I think it's the Apple Newton era of light field. It's just too heavy, having worked in it. here, my analogy is this. You know, I want to put this on my glasses, and this is the state of the art in miniaturization. It's just too heavy. But VR is going to happen. It's my personal opinion that this is the Apple Newton moment. So again, you've seen all these. Well, backing up, there is something that, you know, if you know deep nets, they have these little kernels, and these are little kernels that they can use as a basis, overdetermined basis function, to give the light field. But you know that's kind of the thing that deep nets do. They have these kernels, convolution kernels. These are deconvolution kernels. And so the potential should be obvious that deep nets have a potentially large role to play in light fields. Now, we're starting to experiment with it because when you play with deep nets, your big problem is too much data. And so, when you play with light fields, too much data. You've got 50 imagers coming. It's hard to even store it. So, of course, we're starting to think of, like, how do you reduce it? One way to reduce it is obvious. You get rid of the noise as much as you can because that ruins the MPEG and lossy compression. So you get rid of the noise up front, and you get nice lossy compression that can decompress. But this is very alluring. Like, if I were doing deep nets in vision, I'd be here instead of trying to compete on ImageNet or something, right? Because this is brand new territory. And you know the trick, if you're the first one there, everybody has to cite you. So that's the student advantage. But okay, so what are we doing? It's sort of, we're looking at that, but we're actually doing like a more meta version of this, and that is we're actually trying to take this information and use the machine learning to enhance creativity of story makers. Now, the first enhancement is something we can get a check for. They do everything by hand in Hollywood. Like, all this cool computer vision is actually done by shipping it off to India and wherever, and people click on pixels. They click on the segmentations. There's often 100 people per frame in decent graphics. If you're watching Game of Thrones, there's probably 100 people on every frame. We think we can automate that. Well, what does that do? It gets us a paycheck, but it also starts making it cheaper for a new level of cinematographers who don't have the rotoscoping abilities and whatever. So I'm trying to, like, do what I did for OpenCV to cinematography, is keep the quality and start bringing it down, making it accessible. But there's far more. we're trying to capture the, anytime you do a set, it's very expensive. They close off a street, they rent the room, it's expensive, and you have to have people around. So we want to sort of put more of our cameras there than are needed and really capture it as a digital light-filled asset. And that way, the next time, you can sit at your desk and you can have a street in LA and a conference room and a restaurant and whatever, and you're just renting for $100 rather than thousands, right? So that will open up filmmaking to a larger class. And then, you know, deep secrets of, if we can get that kind of scenery along with graphics. So you know, one of the aims of the company is actually turning film into computer graphics, in that if I filmed you, I could treat you as an object that's completely understood with the lighting and the surface, which is also of high use to the automobile and robot industries. I could get into that, you know, why that makes sense. But we also want to now start linking that with storytelling and, you know, composing scenes and maybe taking narrative or text into the start of movies. And there's all these communities people don't know about, like Wattpad is a fan fiction site, and you'll find books there that have 150 million readers. Mostly it's young women who are writing this. And so it's not known. VCs don't know about this, but it's huge. I mean, there's like 80 million people on this site. They're writing these books. And I thought, well, if you could start turning them into music, then there's other communities, depending on your tolerance for drug use, but there's Tomorrowland. Who's heard of Tomorrowland? If you've heard of Burning Man, right? Okay, Tomorrowland is like that, but like, three times the size, happening three times a year. So probably all this undergraduate students who are wealthy are going to these. Anyhow, it's the same kind of thing. One is in Tennessee. They take a wilderness area, and in a month, they build up a city of a couple hundred thousand, and they put on this big rave there. Everybody's got these bands that, you know, they're medical monitoring. But they're already playing with augmented reality there. The stages are interactive. They're projection mapped. And so weird things happen. And so this is like, you know, maybe you put together narratives with some kind of festival event. And that's where I want to, if this company survives and doesn't just get bought out by Disney, or we don't just end up on the street, that's where I want to push things to. And now, in robotics, do I talk about that? I'm not sure. This is the hiring plea, but we are hiring, not much this year, but we're going to do an A round. We're looking for really strong deep net or coder people right now. These sensors have a lot, like in automotive, I think it's the right thing to do, because I believe, and this is more thesis work, but I think this is an easy one, that light fields can see through weather because you have consistency of rays, and you can just ignore rays that aren't consistent that hit rain or snow. And you'll see through weather, see through fog by boosting signal to noise. There's a lot of things. Now, how would we do that? Well, there's like deep map. They're doing, you know, excellent maps. All they need is the sensor, and we segue into that. Maybe. I want to, once we get these sensors at a decent costs with a decent software pipeline, I want to, you know, seed robotics departments with them, see what they do. I, you know, they can, like I say, if you move back and forth, you'll see you have a lot of information. The other thing, like for drones, like you can see through vegetation, you know, how? Because let's say there's branches of trees, but if I'm moving, I can see through it, right? And all I'm asking is the rays that have, you know, come from a further depth, and I've removed this. We do that all the time at work. You can make someone just turn invisible by seeing around them, and so, you know, that's just play. I think oh boy, how much time do I have? Or what? It's zero. Okay, I was going to talk about cool stuff in robotics, but I ran out. the nature of the mind and how robotics is really an exploration of that. I'll just do a few statements on, you know, like what's above that ceiling or the floor. It's obvious the answer is the inside of your skull. Not the real world, but right below each surface is the inside of your skull. So we're representing this stuff in the brain. This is like, you know, moving towards sentience robots is the way to explore this. Because you have to make a model of self if you're going to plan in the world. And there's a lot of implications. Stanley, all the robots I've been involved with, explicitly or implicitly, have this model of self. And then they model the world. The model is always sparse. We're stuck in that as, you know, Stanley can't understand Shakespeare because the model is not rich enough. To me, it's obvious that this must be the case. We'll never understand the universe. There'll be no universal theories because our brains just isn't rich enough to understand. That's my guess. But, you know, this is, we all kind of live in a matrix, and there's many optical illusions that show that this is so, that you're not really representing the world, you're representing your interior world, which is energy optimized, you know, not to represent things it doesn't have to, that it's seeing. One of the things I say is, like, you know, when you wake up, your dreams don't end, they just connect to an outside data, right? Your synthesizer that you live in is just now correlating with some level of data from the world. Clearly not all, or you'd be overwhelmed. So that was just a ending little screed. I think I'll stop there.